co-chairs. Won't care about me. and I'm one of the co-chairs of Spitfire.
Hey, I'm Anna. I'm the other co-chair of Spitfire.
So, sorry we're running a little late. Before we start, I wrote notes because I was nervous. Thank you so much for coming out. When this art started, we didn't think that we were going to have a lot of people like this. We didn't think we were going to be having a slam. So this is dope. When we started the org last year, we just started it really because we thought that writing was really essential to the process of healing, and we still believe that, and we still think that if you're going to have that process, you need a group to do it with, you need an audience, and so that's why we created the org, and we're so excited that you guys are here. So this competition, in case you guys don't know, is for CUPSI, which is the National College Slam, and this year is going to be in the University of Colorado, and I'm going to say Colorado because I can't say that shit in English. Poets will perform me, and out of those 16 poets, we're gonna pick the four people that are gonna go compete this year.
Okay, so now we have our two beautiful hosts. Should I put this back up here? Because
yes,
yeah. Our two beautiful hosts, Chi and Eddie, give it up.
How's everyone doing tonight? So, Poetry Slam was created by a Chicago construction worker named Mark Smith.
So,
so this is the part where we tell you the rules of the slam. Cell phones, please, if you have them with you, which you probably all do because it's 2013, can you turn them off? And if they're on silent and they're vibrating, we ask that you don't answer a text or a call.
What will happen if they do it?
God will smite you. You'll just be really rude and no one will like you. You won't have friends.
That's a box over here we can throw into the crowd.
That too.
So slam poems are 3 minutes. If you have to move around, do some jumping jacks, like jump with joy out there or go to the bathroom, anything like that, please do it in between pieces. And when you're coming back, wait for there to be applause. Just wanna be polite and respect the poets up here.
And also the best part of a poetry slam besides the poetry, obviously, is the energy that the crowd gets from the poet and that the poet gets from the crowd. What's important to know is that poet can only be energetic if the crowd is. Right, so don't be quiet.
Right. Yes.
We need you to say that you like it. Actually, you need to scream it.
I like it.
Sure. Yeah. So feel free to not control yourselves at all.
Yeah. Just say things like whatever the spirit moves you to do. Just say that.
Yeah.
This is church. Don't be nice. Yes. Yeah. Spit fire, poet.
Be nasty. Be nasty is a favorite.
Ow. So just let it out. Express yourself.
Yeah. Also, if the judges give a score that you don't like, you can say, what you talking about, Willis?
What you talking about, Willis?
Just like that. And you can also say, listen to the poem in a really passive aggressive way. That's all right, too.
But first, judges, stay consistent with your scores.
Yeah.
Audience, feel free to sway the judges.
Beautiful. Okay. Well, all right, for the poets, the rules. Each poem has to be an original piece. No props, no costumes, no musical instruments, no pre-recorded music. Performances should not exceed 3 minutes. Timing starts when the performance or sound begins. You get a 30-second grace time after the score will be deducted by half.
All right, so judges, who are you? Wait, right there?
You got it?
Put your hands up, judges.
Yeah, I did them up.
Show them some love. Yeah,
that's right. Show them some love. Let's butter them up nice. Come on. All right. So thank you for doing this, judges. So they've been selected at random from the audience, and they're given a set of scorecards from 0 to 10, and we will be reading the scores at the end of each piece.
Each score gets added up, and the four poets with the most scores, the highest scores, kind of English, the highest score gets to go to CUPSI. Yay.
All right. So we're also going to read Spitfire's community guidelines, just to kind of give everyone a feel for how a slam works. So one mic, one diva. Mm. Yeah. Not like literal mics, there are two, but like.
Mm-hmm. Not like the thing that Eddie does when he pushes me.
I'm not performing or in the audience.
So he has license to be obnoxious.
I'm not being obnoxious.
Don't be nice, MCs.
Be nasty. Real nasty.
Keep it nasty. What happens in Vegas stays in Vegas, also known as things in this room stay in this room.
Or on Northampton TV.
or the archive, or
the internet. Unless you don't want it to be.
Exert your rights.
Don't yuck somebody's yum. So if people are feeling the poem, please don't boo.
Yeah, no, that's rude. Yeah,
Jesus, that's rude. Don't do that. Also, it's the piece, not the poet. Don't assume that all of the performances appear, or that the poems are autobiographical.
All right, so it's a sad moment, but me and Jeremy going for a second because we have our sacrificial poet coming up. Our sacrificial poet is Megan Gonzalez.
Woo!
And so you guys know what the sacrificial poet's for, right?
No. She's not gonna actually be slaughtered.
So we're actually, like, so there's a pyre out there that needs us, it pleases the gods. But what the sacrificial poet does is that they calibrate the judges. So everyone is either, you know, kind of like the crowds are feeling the poet more than the sacrificial poet or less than the sacrificial poet. So, you know, that's our baseline.
She right. sets the bar, no big deal.
So yeah, let's show some love for Megan Gonzalez.
Why I was surprised. I'm terrible with homeless people. And that's no joke or cop-out. I wish I were better. So when the just barely clean-shaven, second-hand bundled man on the bench asked us for change, stuck gum 3 paces ahead of me suddenly looks so interesting. I always think I'll do it wrong. Maybe what I'll say will come out insensitive. Or maybe when I say I have no spare change, he'll know I'm lying. I'm usually half a mile away before I know the answer to that damn question, spare change. I once had a religion teacher who told us his father walked to work every day in New York City. He passed 20 homeless people on the walk each way. The first time, he gave all the quarters he had, one to each who asked. And on the second day, and on the third, until simple math balked, that would cost him $10 a day, and 50 for the week. So he ceased and shoved his hands deep into his pockets and soldiered on when asked, spare change? In first period religion, I was too busy passing humdrum love notes to my then girlfriend, so I didn't pay this man a cent of attention. But with my quasi-Catholic background, I'd imagine the point of the story was to give in other ways. Upon reflection, I surmise I didn't really get the lesson because I'm terrible with homeless people. I have 2 left feet when I shuffle to the far side of the sidewalk with my hands practically scaling the shop walls and windows. Also, I'm jaded. Once I visited Tokyo, I emerged onto the street sweating out a sticky summer subway ride. An old woman caked in dirt surrounded herself with her belongings like a raggedy bunker. And it was so hot, and I was 17 and itching to be a martyr. Turning on my heel, I marched up to the kiosk and bought her a towering plastic bottle of water. Placing it at her toes like a sacrifice, her lungs pushed forth barely 2 words with a raspy question-like intonation. Though in Japanese, I held on to those words all day, repeating them to myself when I was close to forgetting. When I was home for my host to translate, I told her the story and she laughed. While I imagined the woman commending my fertile selflessness, she had merely muttered, only water? So maybe I am jaded, but I'm terrible with homeless people. It was nothing out of the ordinary today when I averted my gaze and pretended I was deaf and foreign. I really am such a child. When I'm alone, I can usually repress the shit out of shameful things I do, but not today. Today I watched a woman catch the spare change question like a pop fly to the infield. It fell upon her ears, and she turned on her heel into the line of fire. Voice like a paintball gun splattered him with the statement, I have no change, but I'll buy you a coffee. He bartered to no avail, and though change was his aim, he settled for a large with 3 sugars she promptly purchased. If God had a sense of humor, he'll leave a that was easy button for me to step on as I followed her out of the coffee shop. I was like a virgin on Pornhub, gasping at that initial aha moment. Oh, so that's how you do it. Boil down a label, and for the most part, you simply have an adjective. The trick is to determine whether the word enhances a persona or stigmatizes one's description. Remove homeless from the sentence, and you simply have person. I don't know why I was surprised. And the next time I'm asked, I'll have much more than changed.
What's the total time to keep her score? What's the total?
Okay.
Points.
Give him time, give him time, give him time.
Okay, what's 7 plus 5?
32.5?
I don't know math. Is that 32.5? Yeah. That's 32.5.
Internalizing the metaphysical, forcing your ideals to your core so that your entire existence stems from your own constructed conception of what is moral in this world. Social justice is your morality. Force it to your core and live it. Social justice is about calling yourself out more than you call out others, whether that be checking your privilege or facing your oppression. Social justice is about giving everyone access to the collective consciousness of our existence, allowing everyone to participate in the reciprocal relationship between the universe and the individual. It says, yes, what you think and the way you feel does contribute something to the universal understanding of the human condition. It leaves no epistemic rock unturned, no corner of the collective consciousness unexplored. Social justice is about using the I to understand the we. It is about using the we to reflect on the I. It is about filling voids not with flawed cognitive assumptions, but with physical and metaphysical experiences. It is about feeling her skin against yours and her breath against your neck, all while you are contemplating why you are here and who you are. It is about seeing a kid learning to ride his bike for the very first time on a breezy autumn day while his mentor yells, just keep pedaling, and suddenly recalling a memory that would have been lost in the stale California air had it not been for that one moment you decided to care, that moment you decided was special. Attributing meaning to every component of existence is part of living life deliberately. Every moment, every choice, every breath, every thought is not special until you stop to acknowledge the beauty in your existence, until you let yourself be worthy. Worth does not mysteriously embed itself into our souls. It falls like a leaf from a tree. It is when you pick it up and break it down in your hand that you understand how every piece of its being contributes to its ability to please you. Similarly, every piece of your anatomy matters when you break down in her arms. Your skin, your head, and her lap contributes to her being and her existence too, because that is what friendship is about. Yeah. Internalize womanhood. Don't let it slip away into the void, into the whirlpool of theory and thought. Live it, define it, and be the sure to add your perspective to the immortal collective consciousness of the feminist soul. Make room for others to join you in making history. Men make history alone, women make history together. Womanhood is like nature. It forces us not to focus on what the world could be, but what the world is. Enjoy your womanhood. Enjoy the 2 months out of the year where everything is the most beautiful, where everything is dying just to start living again after the sky gets to shed its tears and the earth gets to freeze them in their place to remind us that it is okay to be sad sometimes. Nature gets depressed too. That's why all the leaves fall and dissolve into the earth while the trunks stay grounded in the only thing they know to be real. Trees let the sky be sad so they know it will smile when the leaves need to spread their wings and fly. Embrace the seasons of being human. A leaf is always worthy of justice, even if it is never picked up. Don't let fall pass you by.
Eight.
And we have another nine.
Okay.
Beautiful. Nine plus nine plus nine. How does that spell?
in a van, through Hicktown spotted with Jesus billboards, past white top and yellow top buggies, to the next county's county fair. My sympathy at the cow's bulbous, milk-filled udders, which were ready to explode with white, to pour white everywhere, was assuaged by a carton of chocolate milk. It must have hurt them to watch, but they chewed idly, avoiding conflict. We have to keep them in pain so they are beautiful. That's why we carry the pigs upside down by their feet, why we stomach their murderous shrieking, pure victim amplified. The girls who work with the pigs are always the smallest, too. They name them when they're pink, suggesting rosemary with a lisp. And then do the girls change their minds when the pigs develop the odor? It's a ripe one, stale Walmart cereal, warm milk, every meat except their own. But that's why. That's why they have the canes and we have the ropes. We hit the cows to get them to move faster. When they're small, they step on our feet. And when we're small, we feel it through our neon rain boots. The cows weigh several hundred pounds. And isn't that a big baby? Last year, some of the girls were here when a calf was born. I was jealous, but yet I looked away, cringed during the live birth video we watched in school, The Miracle of Life. My classmates shrieked in the background, conjuring images of pigs. Birth is supposed to be beautiful, but there is so much blood. The pigs are supposed to be beautiful for the show. Carry them, hose them off, put them in the barn.
Woo! Literally, not figuratively.
Yes.
Yeah. Have you seen the afterbirth? I'm so sorry, are the judges ready? I just want to. It's really fucked up. We have an 8.
Another 8.
What's another poem? An 8? A 7.5.
What? Come on, women!
Listen to the poem. And we have a. We have a 7.
Wow.
I love you, Ellen. What's the, how do you add that?
30.5.
Okay, that's 30.5. Next we have Coco Young.
Something intoxicating about their skin. When it brushes yours for that second, cool skin, dark room, red hot bodies don't stop for that second. And I know I shouldn't have been staring at his lips, but did they say I love you at some point, or was that just wishful thinking? You know what? Fuck this. I was 6 weeks sober, and then he comes along again, and I could look, red gold hair and skinny muscles under the sweater I used to wear. I could listen, gravelly voice, slow laughter, deep, filling the room, refilling my cup again and again. And thank God I didn't smell him, because one breath of that Old Spice Denali rough, warm scent, and I'm doing shots. I could bounce back from this. Hand in my chip, reset the clock, start again tomorrow. I could bounce back. It has been 24 hours since my last love. But I'm 1 foot off the wagon, looking for his go-ahead to jump.
Really? Look, sorry. That was beautiful.
That was great. Thank you.
Alright.
Silence!
We have a 9. A 9, alright. 8.5.
Wow.
We have an 8. Happens like the judges will give like low scores and then it'll come to Ellen and then she just gets like the brunt. I'm sorry, it's an 8.
Oh, oh Ellen.
Always happens. Love you so much. Jesus. Oh, what's that? What is that?
33.5.
30. Thank you.
Let's just give it up for the timekeepers real quick.
That's so real. If you weren't here, we would constantly be on the spot. Like, add that right now. 1, 2, 3, 4. Out of hands.
I can't do any kind of math.
Okay, let's see. Up next, we have Marnie.
Until it's published. I had a dream last night that you pressed your big German nose against mine, and I whispered low, "How are you?" You closed your eyes the way you do, thinking about the physics of things, said soft, "I'm okay." A list of things I don't miss about you.
Let's go.
You're cheating on me. You're not holding my hand in public. You only ever tried 3 sex positions.
Let's go. Yeah.
Where the fuck did foreplay go?
Let's go.
You're bad at making breakfast. You don't appreciate my beliefs, ideas, compassion, hardship. You never rubbed my back, tried to fuck instead. The awkward shirts. Get the right size. Your lack of appreciation when I packed you lunch every day for 4 years, you watch shitty porn.
Let's go.
Never appreciated that I know exactly how you like your coffee. Make it right every single time, every day. I gave you Roadhead and wrote you love poems. I could have left so many times, never did. You said I could trust you. I did do that. A list of things I do miss about you. The way you smell. The way you hum when you drive. Our arguments about books. The way you kiss my spine. The freckles on your shoulders. The way you appreciate sculpture. The way you appreciate good food. The way you appreciate every food, frankly. The way you loved my baby sister. I miss your handmade cards. I miss the way you came over when I found out Dad was dying. You cried with me. The way you jump in the ocean anytime, any day. The way you drink big, big coffee so fast. The way you drive so slow. I miss your neck. I miss your big German nose. I miss the way you were proud of me. I miss how you were my brother, lover, best friend, caretaker, partner, everything. The Wikipedia page for the 5 stages of grief does not mention that this is a terminal disease. I check your Facebook 3 times a day. It has been 7 months. I lost 4 hours of sleep about you last night. Sometimes I pretend you're waiting for me on the steps of my house when I get home. And it is like you never left. It is like I did not fall for her, like you were at the funeral every day, every night. You might as well have been, because I cannot seem to give you up. You are so special. I did not sleep well last night. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay.
At 9.5.
Yeah.
My mother put me in dresses and sang my name like a bird song. I was her little girl, who wore butterfly shirts and yellow skirts and made up worlds of fairies. But when I grew out of my dresses and chose jeans and t-shirts instead, she stopped singing. Woo! I became the girl with good grades and a ponytail, hoodies and t-shirts and long jeans and sneakers every day. Every formal event meant a chorus of, "Is she wearing a dress?" My mother was only proud at Girl Scout events or dance recitals.
Let's
if you don't know the feeling of disappointing your parents, I envy you. It's too hard to write an angry poem. The war cry makes my throat ache, but we need to speak about this. The fact that a color can embody an idea is a power that never should have been abused. Just because I don't like pink doesn't mean I'm a tomboy. Doesn't mean I can't do other girly things, and it doesn't make me not a girl.
Yes.
Pink is not pleasing to me, and screw you for thinking that my likes and dislikes are the entirety of who I am. Why should the gender the society assigns me like a warning label dictate everything I enjoy?
Let's go.
I played with Barbies for years.
Let's go.
I made them wear dresses and have boyfriends and too many babies. And I don't regret those days, but when middle school came and I liked pants and sports, my mother said she wished I was more girly. I wish she realized she could have loved me as I was. Children are not made to order. You have to love them for them. Love them for their smiles when you kiss their nose and scold them if they punch their little sister. Don't love them for playing dolls and scold them for wearing a sweatshirt.
Let's go.
Don't spend years pining for pink and purple when there's so many beautiful shades of blue. Just because they don't wear certain clothes doesn't mean they don't love you. To my future daughter, I say, if you like skirts, then wear them. Your nail polish is awesome. Dirt's awesome, too, and it's not just for boys. You look beautiful in those clothes and everything else you ever wear. Because when learning to tie her shoes is an accomplishment worthy of getting ice cream, and learning to spell her name is a cause for celebration, the last thing I want my daughter to worry about is if mommy will love her, whether or not she's girly.
Tell you, you have already been assured. You are smart, you are wonderful, you are beautiful. Really don't mean all that much when you can't hold yourself upright against the weight of the world. I am not your savior. These words weren't even meant for you. Two, you're really pretty. Three, I'm still not really sure if I was in love with your relationship or with you singularly. During the reign of the Spanish Empire, the queen unified the world. When she died, the entire universe would darken in mourning. In Lima, they would build a cathedral, scream and moan, tear at their clothing. Every church would send a representative to show how absolutely wrecked they were because of the loss of a woman they never even met. Both of you would probably hate to be called queen. But you, as a relationship, aren't really around to stop me anymore. Shit. Sometimes I wish I were famous, so then someone could take this video and show it to you. Ask him, didn't you used to know her? Ask her, do you know who this is about? Here's your cathedral, darlings. Four.
I've been told to stop dwelling in the past, but with you and I tangled in my bed, New Year's Eve, up in our quiet little world, perfectly constructed for two, and you seared on my taste buds, my retinas, my thighs, you don't feel like a memory.
Let's go.
Ow, ow.
Five. Girl in the mirror, keep your fucking chin up.
Let's go.
Yes. Duct tape and super glue will hold you together when your own arms fail. Six. Little brother, do you remember when we would open all the umbrellas in the house and create a make-believe city? We must have brought in a lot of bad luck. With that and all the cracks I've stumbled over, it's really no wonder both of our parents have broken their backs. Mom was strong, but there was no way she could hold it all, so it spilled over to Dad, shattering them apart. One, two, three, six, five, four. Sometimes you tear up your poems to search for an ounce of truth. Sometimes the cost of sending a letter is too high. My parents always sent my letters to Santa, so I was never taught how to address mail to people that didn't exist.
Yo, that poem was beautiful. I just got slapped, like, with joy over there. Don't stand next to Marnie. Judges, what do you have for us?
9.5.
Okay! Ooh, ooh, a 9.5. But guess what? Another 9.5.
Okay!
And a 9.
Divided by zero, as the number of particles in the universe and stars in the nighttime sky, five times the slope of a sinusoidal wave plus the very last digit of pi. I am the error in your calculations. Reach out for my arm and I will pass through your fingertips like Adam's assert that I am the irrational one. When any fool can see we have no chemistry, wrap your mind around the fact that I have a say in what I do. What I will not do, and what I will never do with you, because no formula you throw at me or attempt to plug me into will get around the problem of me plus you never coming out the way you want it to. I don't care what your father thinks about women who play hard to get. I don't care how your mother feels about grandkids. I am not difficult, like a game of chess, or one of your thousand-piece, two-dimensional puzzles. There is no rule book, no equation, no trick to simplifying me. I am not your problem. And I was never asking to be solved.
Let's fucking go! We have a 9.
have Anna Beatty.
In the mirror, watched the pink sunrise you burned into my scalp with ammonia bleach. Your neon-stained hands built a seawall against conformity. And we're fighting a war we can't win but haven't lost yet. America can't stone us. Just try to teach us our own destruction. When you were 12, they said you'd go to hell. Who the fuck says that to a 12-year-old?
Yeah.
You drank coffee with double espresso, 9 sugars. Bled purple hair dye on Starbucks plush chairs. Tried to scratch yourself off the planet. Jailbreak out of life. Guess what? You'll come out alive because you have too many stories and you care too much. Because you refuse to let go, and so do I. And I walk into Cooley Dickinson looking frantically for directions to you. And the fluorescent light hits me, bitter, stale coffee, disinfected stink, and squeak of white linoleum floors. And I lead the way to the elevator and crack jokes about how the rest of us are crazy, only they haven't caught us yet. And I squeeze your real solid body, as if I could press my blood into your veins, my skin under yours, and not ever let go. Because, my sister, I love you, and I am angry. And after I leave, my feet will not stop. And I'm crying in the juice aisle in Cereo's market. I read the labels 3 times. Cranberry color of blood, pineapple color of sunlight. In fancy glass bottles, I can't bring with me because the nurses are afraid of what you could do to yourself. And I want to know what to blow up in order to save you. But this isn't Skyfall, and I'm no Bond, just a non-violent teenager. With no villain in sight and no way to get you out, I want to jailbreak you out of the psych ward, out of the patriarchy, out of Carmel, New York, and your dad's smashed drywall house, out of the DSM-5 and the Book of Leviticus.
Yeah.
Yeah. Go.
Because when my heart stopped, you held me and slapped me back to life. And your rainbow skirt burns a hole in white skull walls, and your hair grows green with spring. You belong in the world of the living, and you will come out alive. Oh my God.
Sneakers colored by fear, mistrust, anger, and tried to run my race on the red track of my town, my city, my suburb, my country, and dared to call it life. Life. I want to live free, so I'll have to trade in these beat-up sneakers and continue the race where you left off. I'm not like you. I don't speak in the fake American accent. You spent hours watching Nickelodeon cartoons when you were younger than MTV trying to perfect. I'm not boy crazy or impatient to have a boyfriend because my worth and social standing does not rest on the status of my relationship to men. I did not draw thick circles around my sleep-deprived eyes in front of middle school and high school bathroom mirrors, and I never owned a single North Face coat or a pair of Uggs. I'm proud of the hand-me-down childhood I shared with my brother, moving from country to country, so because my parents were fearful for me as much as they valued education and safety. So I forgive you for wanting. those things because you're humiliated because of what you didn't have. I am an immigrant, so don't ask me if I belong. The United States is a land built of immigrants, and you should be ashamed to hold on to your nationality without knowing the history of your roots. My parents jumped to New York, paved in gold and glitter, and were received by hostile co-workers and bosses who doubted their abilities because they spoke in a tongue between two languages, and I felt the bitterness they brought from work to home in the form of a family estranged by white middle-class Americans in the districts we moved to and from, who thought assimilation should be the solution no matter how painful. I too thought assimilation would help me, but from my classmates who never read the world section of the New York Times, if they read newspapers at all, they didn't know New Zealand was a country in fifth grade, so I shut my mouth until I lost my accent, solved their culture by suppressing my own, stopped becoming a practicing immigrant, and internalized becoming American. I was a child mother of exiles, expecting to come to a place where the poor, tired, huddled masses yearning to breathe free. I was a child exiled in your shores, on your stone pavements. You lied when you said you welcomed me. Well, the lakes of the city glittering, they're burning with pretentious solace. You are pompous, ugly with hatred, distrust of those you pledged to welcome. I breathed dust in tenements, didn't think twice about my anglicized names, went to schools with teachers who didn't look twice at me, colorblind and ignorant of learning differences, immigrant diasporas, shame because became a shadow, then a second self. It took a few years, but it is I who welcome you and speak so that you can hear me, mother of exiles. Hear me, an immigrant who learned endured long enough in your shores to embrace my heritage. Hear me, proclaim love of myself, child of three cultures, and be on my way to becoming a naturalized citizen.
Accepting the long waited for silent scene. I used to have my hair curly, but it wasn't the right curly, curly, not loose enough curly, not smooth enough curly. I had to recurl it in order to straighten it correctly curly. I had to blow dry it to give it the right texture curly, and then I would flat iron all of it to make sure it was thin enough, sleek enough, white enough. We took the stigmas of hair and femininity placed in our communities and implanted them into our skin tones. They told us that coarse, thick, viva la revolución, mind of its own hair is too big, too experienced, too afro, too loud. And we accepted it because we silenced our hair the numerous times we've been silenced since Europeans found us in our empires and thought it'd be cute if we traveled to new places together. I learned to love my hair because I learned to listen to it. Resilience in every aspect, it will always come back. Permed, blow dried, flat ironed, all at the touch of a little water. It is alive. It is talking. Listen. It convinced me, cut me off and let's start fresh. Maybe I'll forgive you. Maybe I'll behave. And all I needed was the right conditioner, the right moisturizer, the right wiping foam, the right silky pillowcase, the right patience, the right mindset, hermanas. Woo! I'm going to wear my hair like the untamed mane that it is, and no one will be allowed to touch it because it is only for goddess and I am sacred. Listen to your hair. It is alive and it is talking. Ow!
Your thighs make love to each other every time you walk. forget that, as you often will. Someone will make love to you, cut you open, and count every ring of your tree ring, reminding you of how long you've lived, the places you've been, and how your life is written all over your tree thighs. Dear someday daughter, when I was your age, I too was afraid to eat, but now I can finally tell you that I know what the world tastes like. And shit, they say nothing tastes as skinny feels, but I say, damn, life tastes pretty delicious.
People who apparently don't know what the word means. No. I have only just become cynical. I used to think patriarchy was an accident, an unfortunate series of events, something that just sort of happened. But now I am sitting on the front porch, shivering and chain smoking, watching my friend cry because her ex-boyfriend called to say happy birthday. She had finally forgotten the sound of his voice, but now it is all coming back. He is telling her that all her friends are bitches. He is telling her to go back to sleep or at least lie still so he can finish. He is telling her that she is not allowed to leave him. The last girl to call the cops ended up in the hospital, and he is still living down the street. I am reading an article in the newspaper about another teenage girl and how much she had to drink and what her past sexual experiences were and exactly where the hemline of her skirt fell. Searching, searching, searching for what she did to make this happen to her. How could she have let this happen to her? I have been cynical since the day I realized that fairy tales are not real. But now I know it is worse than that. They are half true. Prince Charming doesn't exist, but the monsters do. I am 19 years old, and I will not stand within arm's length of a man I don't know. There is a permanent mark on my hip where the knife I keep there digs into my skin. And as I am writing this, I am thinking that I must add a disclaimer. Apologize to all the men out there who are good guys. Right. But then I am wondering why I think I owe them anything. You will have to go elsewhere if you want to be commended for being decent. That is the very least I expect from another human being.
Right.
Because none of the things I have talked about just happened. happen. They are acts that are committed by perpetrators who are systematically protected from consequences.
Let's go! Woo!
And at the very minimum, we are allowing it. To hold. The fact that you aren't skin and bones, that you don't have sharp corners and hard lines, is the reason your friends always sat on your lap instead of the extra chair.
Let's go.
Is the reason your shoulders are the place people come to cry, the reason they go to you for hugs when they think they are the ones who need them. Do not be ashamed. Your hands may be covered in the scars of old paper cuts, and the skin rough and cracked in the winter may be full of hangnails and calluses, but the indents in your fingers are just the footprints of pencils that sketch music notes into staff paper in the middle of the night. The tiny red slashes are simply battle scars worn like war medals from late nights and early mornings and missed meals filled with the smell of old paper and book glue and the next adventure on the next page. They are the war paint of all-nighters and morning of papers and the extra inch that grew into an extra mile because if this kind of determination got you into college, maybe it can help you go bigger places too. Your nails are cut short because piano keys and violin strings sound marginally less angry when you don't have to battle inch-long claws, as well as not enough practice and too much impatience. But they are still short because you are still trying. Wear them with honor. Your height may have made you taller than half the boys in high school, but you wore heels anyway because a man who was intimidated was not worth your time. Remember that strength. And when someone needs to borrow not just your hand or your shoulder, but your spine, share some of the extra length to help hold them up. Be proud. Remember that emotions do not make you weak, so tears should never be hidden. Remember that you can change your hair, you can cut it and dye it and destroy it, and it always grows back so you can start over. Remember that your glasses cover the soul in your eyes, and sometimes it's nice to see the world in soft colors, like a photograph out of focus, rather than the HD clarity of reality, but that doesn't mean you have to leave them behind. Remember that being smart is a good thing. Remember that being compassionate is a good thing. Remember that being happy is a good thing. And when the voice in the back of your head whispers poisonous questions of your own self-worth, tell it, I say you are worth it, and you deserve it, and you do not need the world's approval. So dear girl in the mirror, don't ever forget that you are beautiful.
Thank you so much.
You have called already?
No, I'm fine.
I'm 5'2".
We have an 8.5.
What's that, my one?
We have an. Are you rebelling? We have an 8.
What?
What are you talking about?
We have an 8. 33.5. Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, 33.5. She does like this little half nod. She's like, yeah, okay.
All right, next we have Elena Cross and Ayala. All right, let's keep going.
Until she understands what cooking food separately really means. And I want to tell you that your beans don't have the same flavor without the chorizo, but that my body just can't digest it. And I know you already think I dance on alien moons because I season my tofu with sofrito and cilantro. And I know that it's hard to cook for me because I'm gluten-free, lactose intolerant, have a paralyzed digestive tract, irritable bowel syndrome, and on top of that, I'm a fucking vegetarian. Abuela, I'm confused because I say bendacion, asking for a blessing. Instead, I get implications of all the different ways that my love is a faggot, a sinner, a natural, a phase, confusion, dirty. Today, I don't need arroz or frijoles. I need you to step away from the hot stove you call home. Put down your spoon and look at me, not at the person you need me to be. And she asks if I have a boyfriend. I want to yell, Abuela, I'm gay. But instead, I stay quiet and I think, maybe I can find a dyke that looks just like a boy so there'll be no more questions. Maybe there are wrinkles on her face that I'll never understand. Love is not something you always have to understand. Abuela, no pollo en mi arroz. Abuela, I'm in love with a woman. Abuela, she broke my heart last spring. I miss your pasteles. I need you to love me for all of me. Abuela, I don't want no more comida. Abuela, sometimes I feel like mismatched socks.
Let's fucking go.
And I know being gay is not a sin, but trying to convince you to believe me is the thing that hurts. Sometimes it feels like a moonless night sky bartering for stars. Sometimes it feels like Play-Doh-filled potholes hiding behind circus masks in church. And this year will be the first Thanksgiving without you. Okay. And we are running on borrowed time. I cling to the urgency to tell you before it's too late that Thanksgiving won't be the same without you, even though I still won't be able to eat your frijoles. And it's still hard to please me, but Abuela, I invite you into my sanctuary. Are you coming?
Relationships, 8,926 nights of restless sleep, 40,627 bad dreams, 5 suicide attempts in 3 years, 3 types of medication, 678 panic attacks, 15 one-night stands trying to feel some relief, 45 scars on my arms, 2 tattoos to try and cover them up, 7 years of abuse, 1 childhood cut short, and all because I didn't lock the door. There is strength in numbers. 5 times I've heard another person's story. 20 times did someone ask what they were wearing. 16 times did someone ask if they were drinking. 2 times did someone ask their age. Only once did someone ask if they were okay. 45 times I've heard someone blame the victim because their skirt was too short. So let me ask you, was my nightgown too short too? Is it my fault I didn't lock the door? Is it my fault I felt safe enough in my home that I didn't lock that godforsaken door? There is strength in numbers. 15 times he told me to shut up. 3 times he put his hand over my mouth. 6 times he told me he would do it to my little sister. Every time I submitted out of fear that he would. 33 times of self-denial and pain. 46 hours in a recovery hall because I had tried to take away my memories from it all. 13 years of silence, 18 years old, still blamed for the choices of a 5-year-old. There is strength in numbers. 6 family reunions where I have seen him there. 10 times he asked me how I felt this year, each time commenting on my developing body. 30 times I cringed from his hand touching mine. Countless tears rolling from my eyes because it's my fault I didn't lock the door. 3 times he said, "You're so enticing." 6 times he said, "It's your fault for what happened." 8 times he said, "You should have locked the door." But there is strength in numbers. 13 years of silence, 6 months of being open about it, 2 tattoos to remind me of my will, 30 pieces of silver for the traitor of my youth, 1 mirror I have to look into, 3 times I tell myself it's not my fault. 3 times I stare at my eyes and remind myself it is not your fault. 6 times you wanted to blame me for what you did. 3 times in the morning I deny you because there is strength in numbers. You can blame me as long as you want, but the truth of the numbers is I was 5 and you were 21.
Oh, fucking
minute break. Oh shit, no, we have the score first.
Yikes.
We have a 9.5.
Oh.
We have a 10.
Oh.
We have another 10.
Oh.
And we have another 9.5.
Oh.
To a top 8 because there were 3 similar scores. Moving on to the next round, we have Isabel. We have Carmen. We have Summer. Emily. Natalia. Catherine. Marnie. In this like this range. Okay.
Next up we have Summer.
Go Summer. Don't be nice.
My mind, oh, whoops, sorry. Can I?
It's always cheap.
It's always cheap.
No, you gotta twist it around.
What?
Oh, Jesus Christ. I don't care. Got it. Cheers. Good.
Oh,
I got it. My mind races at 120 miles an hour. It's constantly spinning with thoughts.
The light is on. The children are hungry. We have to make dinner. Did I lock the door? Hurry, hurry, hurry. Grandma needs her medication. Did I forget to turn off the stove? Shit, I have a paper due tomorrow. Remember that time you called your teacher mom? That was embarrassing. You're such an embarrassment. Okay, stop. That was a long time ago. Where are the pots? Stop. Please stop. Great baby crying. I'm hurrying. Can I sleep in? No. Hurry, hurry, hurry. Faster. Keep going. Only weird girls stop to breathe. And I just want the noise to stop. Yeah. I want to hear silence in my mind. Not static, not beautiful poetry, just silence. But silence doesn't reach you when you're a piece of broken glass, when you let yourself be bullied, not by the outside world, but by your own brain that raised you, when you stare into the mirror and want to scratch out the eyes of the girl staring back because you know that girl is ugly, she's empty and sad. Someone break this mirror so I don't have to look back. Shut up. I just want my mind to shut up. When I was 15, I wanted my mind to be silent so bad, I thought putting a knife against my heart stop it from beating. But if my heart stops, the brain still goes for 8 minutes, and the whole time I know it would be shouting, look at what you did, you selfish whore! Look at the mess you made on your mother's clean floors! And they call you lazy, slow, and dumb because you can't get out of bed to face the rising sun. The sun is too hot, it's burning into my skin. There are people laughing and enjoying themselves, but I need to stay in. My mind won't shut up. It keeps talking to me. I can't hold a conversation without thinking, do you like me? Do I annoy you? I'm sorry if I do, I'll leave you alone. I'm sorry, forgive me, will you? I can't love myself because there is nothing appealing, and it doesn't matter what you say. It doesn't matter that you said I had the most beautiful smile because you were fucking me at the time, and I'm positive all your words were poisonous lies. They were sent to convince my mind that I wasn't a broken shard of nothing. And baby, baby, I'm sorry I couldn't kiss you without fear. I'm sorry I couldn't hold you without thinking this time would be the last. And I had to get it right or else heaven may open up and smite me down to hell because they know I don't deserve love from you or anyone else. Because they know I don't matter. Because they know I'm broken glass that's going to cut their feet if not cleaned up properly. Baby, I'm sorry I couldn't stay. It's 4 a.m. and I'm pacing back and forth down the hall. The house is old, the floorboards creak, and there's nothing left to hold. I'm trying to be quiet so I don't bother you, so I'm not a burden on your sleep. My mind won't shut up. It's racing at 120 miles an hour, thinking about everything I did wrong in our bed. I told you too much, I kissed you too little. If I had been a better girlfriend, maybe you would have stayed. I cried too much, I slept too much, I wrote and texted and loved too much. I admired you too much and loved myself so little that when you left, you took everything with you except my mind. And it just won't shut up.
To my phone is a bad thing. I am addicted to the ability to journal my life through every medium the collective consciousness has invented to date. I am addicted to the ability to have meaningful conversations that are divorced from the damaging social constructs of our physical world. I am addicted to the ability to pick and choose the parts of my physical existence in order to construct the optimal metaphysical me. Wouldn't you be addicted to my dependency on my dependency on humanity does not make me weak, it makes me alive. So yes, my existence is validated through the number of people that take the 2 seconds that it takes to tap the heart symbol on Instagram to tell me that my impressive the photo of my impressive fall day is beautiful. I will take this over an existence dependent on the number of zeros that come at the end of my paycheck any day. The only mistake we could make is to leave this unacknowledged. The internet reflects the metaphysical existence of our generation. We cannot let them win. We must claim the internet in a way that optimizes the human condition. We must claim it in the name of social justice. We must not burden our children with the chore to reclaim what should have been theirs in the first place. We must defend our right to participate in the reciprocal relationship between the digital universe and the metaphysical individual. We must defend social justice in the next frontier of existence. We must organize in our position at the forefront of our generation. We were not born after the year 2000. We embody the 20 years that marked the turn of the century from embryo to adulthood. This generation will not exist for another 980 years. The first century of our modern conception of time was marked by the death of Jesus. Let this century be marked with the death of an oppressive economic system that will always kill a miner's canary that would otherwise fly free. Our childhood development occurred in a world without an iPhone, yet our college years will be documented down to every picture of pumpkin ravioli. The only mistake you can make is taking all of this for granted. Wouldn't you be addicted too? We must not waste the momentum of occupying the bridge between the Nokia phone and the iPhone. We must build the bridge to the our phone. We must deconstruct the existential lives capitalism has indoctrinated us to live and discover an existence we know to be dependent on each other. We must not allow them to exploit our metaphysical selves like they've exploited our physical existence. We won't have to be the change we'd like to see if we build the world in which we want to live. They have dedicated their entire existence to building larger screens, faster software, an ideal internet, all to help us map out the human condition. We must draw our maps deliberately. We have been forced to watch imperialist maps destroy our physical world. We will not let capitalist maps destroy the metaphysical blank space that humanity depends on to map its existence. It is the only space we have left. We have the unique opportunity to disrupt 21st century imperialism. We will occupy the capitalist maps that are being sketched in our digital world. And yes, when I say occupy, I am condemning the world 1%. I only use words deliberately, and I will force you to hear my words deliberately. You will not decide the landscape of my creativity. You will not determine the source of my human validity. You will not disarm me from my metaphysical weaponry. You will not define the cartography of my existence. So fuck you if you think my addiction to my phone is a bad thing.
There is no guide. This is no Cosmo. There is no such thing as keeping your sanity. Once you are involved with a Latina, it is game over. Because we are far from simple, except the fact that although you are the man of the house, you are not. Because if mommy wants to go on a diet, the whole house goes on a diet. You are loyal subjects to the almighty queen, and if you treat your queen right, she will king you, and feed you, and love you, and stand by you, and rule you. We are not manuals to read, objects to desire, trophies to display. See, men want women in heels, so we can't run from them. But I am Latina. I clean my house in 4 inches, listening to Plena because the beat beats memories. We have an obsession with perfection and sense of entitlement, and if you can't take the heat, get the fuck out of my kitchen. Because I am not an object, a trophy, nor a manual. All you need to know today, a woman, treat me like queen and I shall king you.
Masquerading estrogen, sister molecule to DDT. Let it fill my lungs as I choke on that popular new car smell. Let it filter in with my food as the dental fillings chip away, leak contact lens to eye. Give praise to my poisoned uterus and breast on this planet full of plastic life. Suck my lumpy and battered milk and fuck the research that says I should let some man molest my chest to encourage healthy development, that I should get pregnant, get milked, get those mammary tissues recycled. As if the only salvation is further violation, as if this is a matter of trespass and consequence, as if we aren't bringing socially constructed ideas of womanhood into the fact that you are poisoning me. We have found the carcinogen that is taking the female population by the tits. If only we could link that back to stunted growth in baby boys' dicks. We might have banned it by now.
Let's go!
Lovers. Three times a day and until we can't keep our eyes open at night.
Let's go.
In my stairwell, in the back of a Corolla, middle of the night on Main Street, behind the post office. In the mall bathroom, the gym bathroom, the library bathroom, the bar bathroom, your fingers in my mouth in Marconi Beach Dunes. I want you on my kitchen counter, drunk out my window, silent in the shower, just loud enough that the girl below us has wet dreams, grabbing your ponytail. I want you choking you against a tree, a shaky finger underneath the restaurant table with your girlfriend in the room over. I want you on the final line of a seminar paper, 7 a.m. on your floor, speeding to 90 on 495 every time you think of my ass. The moment this poem is over, I will give you naked, burnt knees, red thighs, the finest porn you've ever seen. When your legs are shaking and my teeth are bas-reliefed on your shoulder, the universe will open wide and Jesus will come to you and he will say, the world may be crumbling, and yes, you are going to hell, but the sex is spectacular, so it doesn't really matter, right? You will know then that there is prayer in our fuck, that my fingers are redemption, and my tongue is forgiveness for all your precious sins. Your name will be sacred when I whisper it back to you, fire from my throat, 3 times a day, and until we can't keep our eyes open.
The sound of my mother's voice always makes me wonder how far I am from home. Most people carry around stories in their bodies waiting to be released. I end up quoting a lot of people because I'm trying to fill myself up. It's only bad when it's quiet, when the echoes of home are... Sorry. It's only bad when it's quiet, when I have to fill the silence of the fading echoes of home, of voices that are supposed to make me feel more loved, but end up making me feel hollow and wondering what the fuck I'm doing. It's then when I define myself through negative space. I do not smoke, I am not my father. I do not associate shaved head, gauged ears, and covered skin with disrespect. I am not my mother. I changed the way I hold a pen to erase the traces of my mother in my handwriting. Just like Warsan, I have my mother's mouth and my father's eyes on my face there still together. So I wonder, does the echoes of my mother make my father cringe, and do the imprint of my father make my mother feel remorse? And I've torn up a lot of poems. I have ripped them to shreds, asking, if home is where the heart is, when did you become so heartless? Only to realize it wasn't directed at my mother, it wasn't directed at my ex-best friend, it wasn't directed at my ex-best friend, faux brother, almost lover, but at myself. Because family is a raw, gaping wound, and if I could pour myself into any shape, I would pour myself into the wound I caused when I tore myself away. I would knit tendon to bone, muscle, whole, superior vena cava, atrium, ventricle, valve, lungs, atrium, ventricle, let blood fill, flow, flood, muscle to bone, more muscle, a layer of fat, smooth skin, no trace of a scar, because people always want to know your story. And I really don't have time to fill them up with how I was my mother's sunshine and my father's baby girl, because I'm still trying to fill myself up. And all I'm feeling right now are echoes where there should be a pulse.
Thank you, Celia. I'm so proud to have lived with you for a year.
Roommates forever in my heart.
We have a 10.
Ow!
We have another 10. Last but very not least, we have the score. Like, the score is great. You question.
38.5.
All right. Second last, but very much not very least. We have Elena across from Yala.
Nightstand fathers, date rape daddies who never stayed long enough to see their child be born, fathers whose only tie to their child is a last name on a birth certificate, only fathers through Hallmark cards sent 2 weeks after your birthday. I am not writing this for you. This is to the daddies who stayed, the daddies who against all odds stayed for you. This is to the father who asked to be called papi but settled for padre. This is to the father who perfected the all-day ponytail and learned how to braid for you. This is to the father who said, child abuse ends with me. This is a testimony to those who stayed. This is to the father who taught you how to ride your bike, drive stick shift, and constructed fairy wings out of pantyhose and coat hangers so you could fly to the places he only dreamt about. This is to the father who faithfully promised to never hit their wives or kids and have been faithful for 30 years. It is a testimony to those who stayed. This is to the dads who made panda bear dioramas, reenacted Hooverville, and let you step on his toes while teaching you how to salsa. This is to the fathers who continuously hated the boyfriends you brought home and accepted you when you told him you were gay. To the dads who never forgot to pick you up from school, who told you he loves you even when your actions made it impossible for him to look at you. This is a testimony to those who stayed. This is to the dads with secrets stashed away in stale cigar boxes, whose fathers tied knots in extension cords to whip childhood inhibition out of him. This is to the father whose father played the sport called child abuse, but asked on his deathbed to be forgiven and forgotten. This is to the dad who forgave but will never forget. This is to the father whose temper he apologizes for, to the father who said, child abuse ends with me, and meant it. This is a testimony to those who stayed. This is to the dads who don't know what happened to their little girl when she was 11, to the dads whose vocab shouldn't include child molestation, physical abuse, suicide attempts, to the dad who must understand that there will be days when loving me will not be enough, when the scars on my leg will be just as fresh as the friendly knives that put them there. There will be days when the silence will be okay, when I will lie about being okay. There will be days. And I need you to know I do not blame you. This was not your fault. You were the best dad I could have ever asked for. This is a testimony to my dad who stayed.
Oh, you guys are so ready, y'all. All right, so the scores that we have are 9.5.
get, oh wait, we need the score.
39.5.
Now you're gonna chill out for a second while we just get everything together for you guys. But can we just give it up for everyone who's performed?
Yes.
You guys rock. Thanks so much for being here tonight. We have exciting news for you about who's going to CUPSI. Yeah! Are you pumped? Are you pumped? You don't sound pumped enough. Yeah! All right, cool. Right on. So we want to give a shout out to the judges. You guys have received a lot of shit from us, but you're fantastic, and we appreciate your diligence.
And your bravery.
And your bravery. And our timekeepers have been amazing. Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Kim.
Yes.
And Emmy. I said Emmy too.
She's like, I'm in
All right. All right, so we have exciting news from Yolandi.
Okay.
This is a dream come true.
Okay, I'm not going to brag. That'd be kind of sensitive. Okay. I'm so excited to announce the four people that I'll be in the team and I'll be coaching, and I'm like so excited for this. So the first person up is Isabel. Groupies and things like that. So stick around and much love. YOLO.